Hello everybody. So today I will be talking about neurodynamics. So myself, Dr. Sneha Bhatia, MPT in orthopedics and sports rehabilitation, in charge principal at Leeds Srimati SG Patel Institute of Physiotherapy. So before I start with my lecture, I would like to say that according to YouTube analytics, 64% of my audience have yet not subscribed to my channel. So please subscribe to this channel. Press the bell icon to get notification for the next video and please share this channel with your friends. So what is neurodynamics? Neurodynamics is the treatment approach developed by Michael Shacklock, who was an Australian physiotherapist, and this approach is mainly used for radiculopathy. So neurodynamics concept was developed by Michael Shacklock. The concept of neural tension emerged by him, and so Michael Shacklock has designed some techniques on his understanding of how the neural tension is developing inside the nerve roots and how mobilizing the nerves can relieve the signs and symptoms of the patient. For example, in case of intervertebral disc prolapse, when there is disc prolapse, the nerve root is getting compressed, and because of there can be sliding dysfunction or there can be gliding dysfunction. So to relieve this dysfunction, how to mobilize the nerve? Everyone is familiar with how to mobilize the joint because it is taught in our syllabus that mobilization of the joint is important. When we mobilize different kind of joints like shoulder joint, knee joint, hip joint, when we mobilize the joint, we give anterior glide, posterior glide, then it is increasing the range of the motion and decreasing the limitation. Suppose a patient is having any limitation of the range of the motion, then it will be decreased. So when we are using the mobilization for the nerves, that is called as a neurodynamics. Okay, so what is the definition of neurodynamics? So clinical neurodynamics is essentially the clinical application of mechanics and physiology of nervous system as they relate to each other and are integrated with musculoskeletal function. So in case of clinical neurodynamics, we are treating the patient by mobilization of the nerves, and we are taking into consideration the principles of the mechanics and the normal physiology of the nervous system, because these systems are interconnected and interlinked. So as we all know that the nerves are passing through the muscles, they are innervating the muscles, so muscles are able to work. We also have a layers called as fascia. So in our bones, in our musculoskeletal system, we have the muscles, we have the bones and the fascia, and all these structures are interlinked with each other. So if there is pathology in one structure, then it can definitely affect the other structure. Suppose the muscle is tight, then also it can impair the mobility of the nerve. Suppose the fascia, there is tightness in the fascia, then it can also affect the mobility of the nerve tissue, which can give rise to radicular symptoms to the patient. Patient may have tingling, numbness. If there is neural compression, then muscle weakness and paralysis also can develop. So neurodynamic test. What is a neurodynamic test? Is a series of body movements that produces mechanical and physiological events in the nervous system according to the movements of the test. So for example, if we say slump test, in my last video I have talked about the neurological test for checking the special test for checking the neurological dysfunction in case of the lumbar spine. So if the patient is having radiculopathy, if there is nerve root compression, what test we are doing? We are doing the slump test. So slump test is also a part of neurodynamics only. So what we are doing in slump test, we are using different kind of movements in sequence. Okay, so first we are doing slouching movement from the thoracic and the lumbar flexion, followed by the cervical flexion, then we are asking the patient to extend the knee, and then followed by the ankle dorsiflexion. So slump test is also a series of body movement which is putting the nerve into tension. So neurodynamic test is a series of body movement that will put the nerve into tension. So while we are stretching the nerve while performing the test, if the patient is having signs and symptoms of tingling, numbness, or the same pain which the patient is otherwise experiencing is reproduced, then the test will be considered as positive. So sensitizing movements, what is called as sensitizing movements? So sensitizing movements, the definition for it is the movements are those that increase the forces in the neural structures in addition to those movements employed in the standard test. However, they are not the differentiating movements. So sensitizing movement means a particular movement. For example, cervical flexion or ankle dorsiflexion. If these movements are increasing the force in the neural structure, they are putting additional stress to the neural structure, then this kind of movement will be called a sensitizing movement. But it is not the differentiating movement, okay? There is a difference between sensitizing movements. So sensitizing movements are those which is putting the neural structure into additional force, okay, under extra stress. Next is the definition. So neurodynamic sequencing is the performance of a set of particular component body movements so as to produce the specific mechanical events in the nervous system according to that sequence or order of component movement. So what is called as neurodynamic sequencing? For example, in the case of slump test, first we are doing the thoracic and the lumbar flexion, followed by the cervical flexion, then there is knee joint extension, and there is ankle dorsiflexion. So this is the neurodynamic sequencing. So this sequencing we are doing so to set a particular component of body movement to produce specific mechanical events in the nervous system. So this is called as sequential steps of the test. So we have to, for each and every neurodynamic test, we have a sequence of a movement. So we have to follow that sequence, then only the nerve tissue can be mobilized, and if the patient is having symptoms because of the nerve tissue, then it can be confirmed. So neurodynamic sliders, what is this meaning of neurodynamic slider? The slider is a neurodynamic maneuver whose purpose is to produce a sliding movement of the neural structures relative their adjacent tissues. So there will be sliding. Everybody knows in case of mobilization, these words are very common. We say sliding and gliding. So when we are mobilizing the nerve, and the slider is the maneuver in which there is production of the sliding movement of the nervous tissue or neural structure, that is called as the neurodynamic sliders. Next is, what is neurodynamic tensioners? So tensioner is a neurodynamic test that produces an increase in tension in the neural structure. It relies on the natural viscoelasticity of the nervous system and does not pass the elastic limit. Therefore, the technique does not produce damage, and if performed gently, may improve neural viscoelastic and physiological function. So tensioner, opposite to the slider. In sliders, neurodynamic slider, there is just sliding movement of the nerve. In case of tensioner, additional stress is put on the neural structure, or tension is generated, extra amount of tension is generated in the neural structure. So what will it do? If we are giving the tensioner, then it will increase the viscoelastic property, the elasticity of the nerve tissue will improve, also the physiological function will improve. Suppose there is restriction of the blood flow to the nerve tissue and we are giving tensioner, then while we give tensioner, the restriction of the blood flow also will improve. Next, there is something called as mechanical interface dysfunction. So what is mechanical interface dysfunction? They occur when the forces exerted on the nervous system by the interfacing movement complex are abnormal or undesirable. So the forces that are acting on our neural system that are abnormal, then it is called as mechanical interface dysfunction. Okay. Next, there is something called as closing dysfunction. What is closing dysfunction? According to neurodynamics, the closing dysfunction is defined as an alteration in the closing mechanism of the movement complex, that is the joint, the muscle or the tissues around the nervous system, producing abnormal or undesirable forces on the adjacent neural structure. So closing means, what is closing dysfunction? It is defined as alteration in the closing mechanics. So suppose we are closing the joint or the muscle or the tissues and around the nervous system. So if during the closing movements the symptoms of the patient are reproduced, then that will be considered as the closing dysfunction, because during the closing movement there will be undesirable forces that will be working on the neural system. So that is why it is called as closing dysfunction. What is reduced closing? Reduced closing means occurs when the movement complex lacks appropriate movement in the closing direction. Okay, so when there is closing movement and there is inappropriate closing, that will be called as reduced closing. There is opening dysfunction. So opening interface dysfunction is defined as an abnormality in the opening mechanism of the movement complex that is located adjacent to the nervous system. As with the closing dysfunction, it also houses two subtypes, reduced opening and excessive opening. So opening dysfunction, as we have already discussed about closing muscles, the joints or the nervous system during the opening movement of these structures, if there is any mechanical interface which is due to which the opening is not happening properly, then it will be considered as opening dysfunction. So it can have two subtypes, that there is reduced opening or there can be excessive opening. So reduced opening, when the movement complex around the nervous system does not open sufficiently or in a desirable manner, then it will be called as reduced opening. What is excessive opening? The excessive opening dysfunction occurs when the opening of the interfacing movement complex around the nervous system is greater than normal or is undesirable, thereby exerting the undesirable forces on the neural element. So if there is excessive opening, for example, we can say hypermobility. So in case of hypermobility, there will be excessive opening that can also give rise to the symptoms or pain to the patient. So what is pathoanatomical dysfunction? It is occurs when an interfacing structure of abnormal shape or size exerts undesirable pressure on the neural element. So pathoanatomical dysfunction, when it is occurring, when there is structure of abnormal shape or size which is putting undesirable pressure, okay, on the neural element, that can cause pathoanatomical dysfunction. Pathophysiological dysfunction, okay. Pathophysiological dysfunction occurs when an aspect of the physiology of the nervous system is abnormal. So this is the picture showing the tourniquet effect, in which the blood flow out of the nerve is reduced due to the pressure on the vein. Internally, a pressure backlog builds up and the nerve becomes swollen and edematous. So we can see direction of the blood flow. The artery is seen there. So there is a swollen area of nerve due to backlog of the fluid. The vein, which is dilated. So there is some object causing the compression, okay, to the blood flow. So this is again the direction, the output of the direction of the blood flow, and compressed vein and nerve can be seen here in the middle section of this picture. So this is called as the tourniquet effect. So because of some reason the direction of the blood flow is altered because of the compression, then the neurological dysfunction may develop. So neural dysfunction, what is neural sliding dysfunction? Sliding dysfunction occurs when the neural structure demonstrates reduced excursion compared with normal or is hypersensitive to sliding movement. So that is the sliding dysfunction. Okay. So there excursion means the movement of the nerve. So when the sliding of the nerve is abnormal, it is called as neural sliding dysfunction. Tension dysfunction is the neural tissues. In the neural tissues occurs when the tension dynamics of the nervous system are abnormal or undesirable, giving rise to abnormal tension in the neural structure, or when they are abnormally sensitive to such events. So key point, tensioner is not a nerve stretch. Stretch implies sudden and permanent elongation in which the elastic limit of the neural structure is passed and results in damage. So don't confuse between the words. Tensioner is not a nerve stretch. For obvious reason, the nerve stretching is not recommended, and instead a tensioner seeks to gently improve the viscoelastic and physiological function of the nerve structure. So this is the picture showing the MNT1, okay. So portion of the therapist proximal hand in preparation of the median neurodynamic test. So MNT is the median nerve neurodynamic test, okay. That is the one part, test one. So here the therapist is having the hand on the patient's shoulder. Second position is showing the hand position, okay. So position of the therapist's distal hand in preparation of the median neurodynamic test. So with the one index finger of the therapist, the thumb of the patient is separated from the fingers. Starting position for the median neurodynamic test, which is shown in the third picture. As we can see, therapist is in long standing position, okay, or step standing position. So one hand is over the shoulder, another hand is holding the hand of the patient. So glenohumeral abduction and external rotation during the median neurodynamic test 1. So we can see this is the position for MNT1. So elbow extension during the median neurodynamic test 1. So then this is the first image. This will be the starting position. From this, the therapist will perform the elbow extension. So differentiation of distal symptoms with contralateral flexion during the median neurodynamic test. So in the event that proximal symptoms are to be differentiated, release of the wrist extension should be performed. So when we want to differentiate the distal symptom, then contralateral flexion of the neck region, lateral flexion of the cervical region can be performed. And if you want to differentiate between the proximal symptoms, then you have to release of wrist extension movement. So this is the technique of the supported median neurodynamic test. Okay, so again here you can see the elbow of the therapist is resting on the couch. So this can be again, this position also can be utilized for MNT1. So this is the picture for the ulnar neurodynamic test. Again, the patient is in walk standing position. The therapist is in walk standing position. One hand is over the shoulder, other hand is holding the hand of the patient. Patient is lying supine on the couch. So scapular depression during the early stages of the ulnar neurodynamic test. So with the hand which is holding the shoulder of the patient, the therapist will perform scapular depression. Wrist extension and forearm pronation during the ulnar neurodynamic test. So there will be wrist extension and forearm pronation. Then next, glenohumeral external rotation. There will be glenohumeral external rotation. So next, scapular depression during the median neurodynamic test 2. Again, the next picture is showing the median neurodynamic test 2. So there will be glenohumeral external rotation and forearm supination. So elbow extension will be performed in the next phase, and then wrist and finger extension during the median neurodynamic test 2. So this is the position, hand position of the patient, and therapist position is also seen in this picture. This is the median neurodynamic test 2. Next, so you have to also incorporate glenohumeral abduction if it is required. Now this is the radial neurodynamic test. So scapular depression first. Okay, so with the pelvis of the therapist, we can put the pressure in the inferior direction and scapular depression can be exerted. And then elbow extension during the radial neurodynamic test, we can see in the second picture. Then glenohumeral internal rotation. So remember, during the radial neurodynamic test, there is internal rotation of the shoulder and pronation is also there. Next, wrist and finger flexion during the radial neurodynamic test, and glenohumeral abduction during the radial neurodynamic test. So these are the component of the radial neurodynamic test. So if the patient is having reproduction of the pain or signs and symptoms which he is otherwise experiencing, then this radial neurodynamic test will be considered as positive. So reference for today's video, I have taken the content from this book, Clinical Neurodynamics, A New System of Musculoskeletal Treatment by Michael Shacklock. So you can also get this book online, and you can read for further reading. You can refer this book. Also, I would like to say that Neurodynamic Solutions are also providing the workshops and seminars for upper quarter and lower quarter. I have also done the workshop from Neurodynamics, and I have got my certification done. So if you are more interested in Neurodynamics, then that certificate you will get from the body, which is Neurodynamic Solution from Australia. So if the workshop is conducted anywhere in the India, you can also participate in that and get yourself certified for neurodynamics from Neurodynamic Solutions Australia. So thank you for watching this video. If you have enjoyed watching this video, then please subscribe to my channel, press the bell icon to get notified for the next video, and share this channel with your friends. Thank you.